Good morning, everyone. Hope you're all having a wonderful day today. I hope you enjoyed that awkward intro as much as I enjoyed having to fit into that very, very small, spooky outfit for the intro. But it's Halloween, so I thought I would do something a little fun. Of course, today we're going to be talking about my AR-10 firearm. This is a inexpensive build. It's not the most expensive build in the world. It's not the cheapest build in the world. But for an AR-10, this is a very high value setup. So, overall, on this setup, we have about $850 worth of stuff, which on the surface sounds like a lot of money, but for a full AR-10 firearm rifle pistol setup, it's actually not that bad. So we're gonna go ahead today, go through all of the stuff that I have on this AR-10, what the actual AR-10 is, some of the things I like, dislike about it, some of the things I would change about it, and what I think its main purpose is. So first up, let's go ahead and talk about the upper receiver here. We're gonna talk about pretty much the heart of the gun, and then we're going to go over and cover all the extras that I have on top of it. So the upper receiver is, unfortunately, it's a billet upper receiver from ABC Rifle Company. It has their billet upper receiver and their bolt carrier group. They're very nice, they're very budget friendly. You can pick up this entire upper without the extra stuff on there for about $350 to $400, depending how you spec it out. Now, the thing that I don't like about the upper and the bolt carrier group combo is that they're both very, very heavy. Billet is very heavy. It has a lot of extra material on here. And because it is a budget setup, the bolt carrier group is also very, very heavy. There's just a lot of material on there. There's not a lot of machining to take that material off. So what you're left with is a very heavy upper receiver and bolt carrier group, which does add a few complications and issues with the rest of this setup. Next up, moving forward from there, we have this rail. This is a Keymod rail, which of course isn't everybody's favorite. M-Lock is a really good one, but in my opinion, they're both really good, especially for what we use them for. So this guy here is a 12.5-inch rail over a 12.5-inch barrel. So it fits very flush and it looks very sleek, though I do have a few issues with it. This rail right here, it's a 6061 aluminum, so it's actually a little bit cheaper than your high quality, super high strength 7075 aluminum rails. So it's going to weigh the same, but it's going to be a little bit less tough and a little bit less durable. Now, this rail was only like $35 online. I got it delivered for right at $35. So I wasn't expecting a whole lot out of it. And the fact that it is a downgraded material from 7075 to 6061, it's not a huge deal. The thing I don't like about it is the machining quality on it. When you get a cheap rail, say from eBay or from wherever else you get your very cheap rails from, what you end up with most of the time is a rail that's not machined very well. It's not very finished. So all of the edges on here are extremely sharp. They will tear up your gloves and your hands if you're using them like this. So in most of my shooting with this guy, it is with gloves, especially when I'm pushing them and slamming them into awkward positions and then shooting from them. This will tear up your hands quite a bit. Now, in terms of a budget build, the machining quality really is not that big of a deal, and it will save you a lot of money, but don't expect the same amount of quality out of your very expensive, more reputable rail manufacturers. Now, the other thing that I don't necessarily like about this rail is that the machining on it is good. The clamp mechanism is really good. You have four anti-rotation screws here that kind of clamps it down, and then you have two set screws on the bottom that go into the bottom of your barrel nut. So it won't rotate and it hasn't shifted whatsoever, even on a very aggressive recoiling AR-10, which is great. But the thing that I don't like about it is that it's 12.5 inches long, which means that it has a couple extra inches on there that I don't need. So basically, I don't like to have rails that are all the way out super far in front of my hands where I'm not actually grabbing onto and not actually using. So I could definitely cut off a few inches of rail space, make it look a little cleaner, and also save a little bit of weight at the end of the gun. Now, moving on from there, let's go ahead and talk about the barrel. And the barrel is actually one of the highlights of this system. It's a 12.5-inch barrel, like I mentioned before. 1-in-10 twist rate, so it's fairly aggressive, great for heavier loads, 165, 168 grains. For me, 168 grains, Sierra Match King, sub MOA out of this guy. With a couple different loadings of Federal Premium and Magtech, their 168 grain Sierra Match King bullets, absolutely excellent out of this barrel, sub MOA pretty much all day. Now, it's a 12.5-inch. The one thing that is kind of a detractor on it is it is a carbine length gas system. Now, if you're buying more expensive barrels, you can get mid-length in a 12.5-inch barrel, which helps to smooth out that recoil impulse. This guy's a carbine length, so you are going to get a very aggressive, very snappy recoil impulse off of a 308, which doesn't make it all that much fun. Now, to mitigate that, we do have an adjustable gas block on here. This is a Cotton Arms adjustable gas block. I've made an entire video on them, and I use them on 3 different guns, and they work excellent. So with this guy, I have it set to mostly off. I like to have it be able to run steel all day, so I have it to where steel is ejecting at about 3:30 or so, but everything else will run about 3 to 2:30, somewhere in that range. So I like it to run everything, but when I'm shooting steel, because I do shoot a lot of steel through my 308s, just because it's so much cheaper than regular brass ammunition for 308, so I do end up shooting a lot. So I do like to have enough gas in the system to run it comfortably. And of course, the gas block itself really only costs $20 to $30, depending on where you buy it from, and I actually am selling it, link in the description. Now, moving on from there to the muzzle device. This is a Radical Firearms Ghost Flash Hider, 5/8 by 24, all that sort of good stuff. It does an excellent job of reducing blast and flash off of a 12.5-inch AR-10. In all of the shooting that you see on the intro and that I'm going to put up on the screen, you're only going to see a couple of flash signatures. Now, granted, it is in the daylight, and if you put this out at night, you will definitely see flashes, but it does a great job of mitigating that. This has much less flash than my 10.5 AR-15 with a much more aggressive flash hider on it. So the Ghost Radical Firearms flash hider does a really good job, and it's only like $8. It's not very long. It doesn't add a lot of weight. It's a very simple, symmetrical design, so there's no need to worry about timing. Really like it, especially for the price. So that's pretty much the main things about the upper receiver. Now let's go to the lower receiver. And now the lower receiver is where we save all of our weight. This is a polymer lower receiver from Tennessee Firearms. They do a really good job with most of their polymer lowers, though there are some issues, and if you read reviews on them and comments on them, it's about 50-50 to whether you get a perfect one or whether you get one that has a few issues. This one does have a few issues and idiosyncrasies. The first one and most important one is that certain mags will drop free all the time, and certain mags, even after you have sanded them down, will not. So in a lot of the video, you'll see me reach up, grab a mag, and throw it out. That's because that mag will not drop free when it's empty. So it is something to keep in mind, depending on your magazine selection. P-Mag 20-25 rounders generally do the best for me, but if you're using off-brand or cheaper magazines, good luck. Now, one other small annoyance that I have with this setup and the polymer lower is that it's really small and gripey, but this pin, the pivot pin, sticks out a little bit farther than it should, so it doesn't really push all the way through, but that's just the joys of owning a polymer lower. However, it does save you quite a bit of weight on your firearm, which is good, especially when you have a very heavy upper receiver. Now, probably the most controversial and the oddest looking part of this firearm is that I'm using a rifle length gas system. So this is a standard A2 rifle length gas system with a heavy 308 buffer in here, which is very heavy. It's like 6.8 ounces or something like that. And I'm using a rifle 308 spring. But again, because this is a firearm, this is not a rifle, it's not a pistol. So it has a barrel that's shorter than 16 inches, but its overall length is like 29 inches. So that means you can't have a vertical foregrip on it because it's technically considered a firearm, and you have to have a pistol brace on it or not a stock on it essentially. So this is a Foxtrot Mic pistol brace. They're like $15 to actually get it to fit on the standard A2 buffer, which is much thinner than your mil-spec type of buffer or pistol buffer. You have to, or at least what I did, was I wrapped it with duct tape until it was really, really tight, and then I just pounded it on with a rubber mallet. And so now it's really stiff on here. So that's what I had to do. It does look very awkward, and at some point this would be a really, really good candidate to SBR, but for right now this is the setup that I have it in. So now let's swap back to the upper receiver and let's talk about the accessories that I have on here and kind of why I have them set up. So starting from the front, we have a Acid Tactical. This is a 800 lumen light, very, very bright. It has a very wide throw. It's adjustable, so I have it set to pretty wide for more close range work, because where I live and where I walk around and do stuff in is very close, so I don't necessarily need a super long, very precise throw on there. I like to have a little bit wider so I can see more very quickly. So And also, Asset Tactical does a really good job on their lights. I own like four of them, and they've all been fairly durable, and I haven't broken any of them, and I don't treat them very well, as you see in the video. And they're only like $30. And also, I think their base is like out of Washington. I live in Washington, so I get them next day without having to pay any extra money. Super nice. Next thing on this guy, we already mentioned that I have a Cotton Arms adjustable gas block on here, which does a great job of reducing that recoil impulse, which is very aggressive on this guy. But right on top of the gas block, I have my UTG Slim forend. This is a fixed iron sight. So, and it also works as a reference point for my thumb. So not only do I have a reference point for my grip down here, but also for my thumb, because it has a very nice groove in here where my thumb just kind of fits, and I can just push down real nice and tight, and I know my hand's in the right position to be able to reach my light. That's really about it. The light was like $13, or sorry, no, the light was like $30. The UTG Slim forend sight, which does a really good job. It's very, very sturdy on here, hasn't moved at all. I got it for like $14. And then on the bottom here, we have one of the BCM, I forget the name of the grip, but it's just one of their key mod grips. It's a very short grip and it's very, very sturdy, but it doesn't add a whole lot of weight, and it works really good and it looks cool, and also is super functional for me anyways and where I live. Slamming it into trees, covers, barricades, whatever have you, to then pivot the gun off of that. So if you don't have a grip on here, you're gonna have to just use your hand and kind of hold the gun against whatever you're trying to put it on. But because I have this foregrip right here, I can just slam it into whatever I need to, and I can use the actual vertical foregrip to hold up the weight of the gun as I'm taking my shot. So everything that you see that I have here on my rail costs about $60. So not very expensive whatsoever. Moving back from there, on top of the upper receiver, we have my optic setup. It's a little silly on here and it doesn't really make a lot of sense in this build. We'll talk about that in a minute. But I have a Trinity Force Veras red dot sight, or Veras red dot sight. I don't really know how you pronounce it, but I think it's Veras red dot sight, which is a excellent, excellent red dot. So it has 11 different brightness settings, I wanna say, from everything from night vision capable to blistering, daylight bright, wide out conditions type stuff. Very simple, easy to use controls. It has an exterior battery, which is a AAA, which is awesome because I have a ton of them lying around. In here right now, I have a rechargeable one. Now, with a full powered battery, it is rated for 50,000 hours of life, just like an aimpoint, and it has auto on off features, which is awesome because when I go to grab this guy, for whatever reason, I want it to be ready to go and I don't need to fiddle and push with buttons. It just turns on, it's ready to go, and I'm not worried about the battery dying. It's also incredibly durable. It's made out of a one piece aluminum body. It's a solid block of 7075 that's milled and machined out and looks really, really good. The machining on it is good. The glass quality on it is really good. It does have a slight bluish tint, so it can throw you off a little bit if you're not used to that. Some optics have that sort of tint, some don't. This guy here does have a little bluish tint, but it's very bright, punchy, crisp, looks great, and it functions extremely well. Now, moving back from there, we have a very cheap 3x magnifier. This is a Tacticon 3x magnifier. It's one of the highest rated and cheapest 3x magnifiers on Amazon. So I was like, okay, I'll just go ahead and give it a try. I think I picked it up for like $40, and it technically comes with a lifetime warranty, though I'm not sure how good their customer service is. And it does a really good job for being a very budget setup. It did come a little bit loose on here, as you can probably hear throughout the video. I just need to tighten it down and throw some Loctite on there and it'll probably be just fine. But it did come a little loose after a couple hundred rounds. Again, this is a very aggressive 308 though. But one thing that I am very impressed with it is that it does have a very good field of view. It's very easy to use. It's very comparable to the $200 Vortex 3MT, I think is what it's called. I used to own one of those. I liked it a lot, but I ended up selling it because I didn't really have a purpose for it. But then when I picked up this guy, the optical quality is pretty much the same with one little caveat. This guy, the Trinity Force Veras, has a blue tint, and this guy has a green tint, which means that when you put using them both in conjunction, you get a very nice brown tint all around your image. So it's not the clearest thing when you use them in conjunction with each other, and they kind of don't mesh very well as they don't really mesh very well with this setup either, but we'll get into that in just a second. So the combination of these two doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but if you're using this guy here with a very clear optic, you're probably not gonna notice it all that much. And for a cheap 3x magnifier, it works really, really well, though I'm not sure I would put it on a 308. Now, what makes it especially bad for this setup is that I have a rather long length of pull for me. I think it's 13 inches from the handguard to the back, which is longer than most of my setups. I'm only 5'9", and so I don't have super long arms. I don't need a super long length of pull. I like to have it closer, tighter into my body. So, and the issue that I have with this guy is that it only has about 2 inches of eye relief, meaning that when I am on the gun like I normally am, I'd be back here. But because this guy only has 2 inches of eye relief, I can't see anything now, and I have to cant my head all the way forward. So this is full sight picture, and this is where I'd like to be. This is full sight picture, and this is where I'd like to be. So it's not really conducive with this build and this setup. I just had it lying around, so I threw it on here. But one last thing to mention is when you flip this guy over the side, you do have easy access to this guy. It works exactly like the Vortex 3MT, I think is what it's called. And in the back, we have a Trinity Force steel flip-up iron sight. So if this guy goes down for whatever reason, you do still have your fixed iron sight up front and a foldable one in the back. So if you need to, you always have access to iron sights, which is nice. And it fits down pretty perfectly under there. So I'm using all of the rail space, literally all of the rail space on the upper receiver. So it is really nice to be able to run your red dot and your magnifier and still have access to iron sights very quickly, very efficiently. And it fits really well in this build. I just don't like the short eye relief, which almost all 3x magnifiers have, especially when in conjunction with this long length of pull. So when moving down to the lower receiver, there's really only two things that are special or really different about it at all. So as I mentioned before, it has a standard A2 buffer with a 308 very heavy buffer and 308 springs. Nothing super cool there, just what you need for a 308. So the only two special things that I have on the lower receiver are this UTG. This is their stubby pistol grip, I think is what they call it. It's very short, it has a shallow angle, and it's a very thick kind of meaty rubberized grip, which I really like the texture of. Some people don't like it, and it does take some getting used to. And the finger grooves, it is something to mention that it does have finger grooves that do match my hands, but they might not match yours, so keep that in mind. I am running this grip on two other guns, and I really like it, and they're only like 15 bucks, so I do recommend them if you're looking for a really good, short, kind of shallow grip. I really like it personally, some people don't. And then we have this Foxtrot Mike pistol brace, which is really the only one that I could think of that would work with a rifle length buffer system. So that's why it's on here, is because I think it is the only one without having to SBR your gun that would work with a rifle length. Although I think there are some other ones from SIG and other things that will work for it, but they're much more expensive, as this guy here I got for 15 bucks. So my intentions when building this firearm were to build a very compact, short, not ultra heavy gun that was extremely capable out to about 600 yards. So 0 to 600, I wanted it to hit very, very hard. I wanted it to still not be super heavy and bulky like a 20-inch AR-15 or even like a 16-inch battle rifle AR-10 or something like that. I wanted something with a shorter barrel that was still very capable of sending very heavy slugs a long distance and that didn't take up all that much space. Now, there are two kind of contradictory things in this build with that mindset. So the first contradictory thing to that is probably, as you noticed, the optic setup. This optic setup is really good for 0 to 300. And of course you can take shots longer. You can always take longer shots. You're just not going to be as precise. So my ideal optic setup for this guy would be like a 1 to 8, something in that range, or even a 1 to 6 would be perfect for that 0 to 600 yard range and still give you a lot more precision without losing too much on the close end of things. And the other thing that's kind of contradictory with the short, compact 0 to 600 yard rifle is of course this rifle length gas system, or sorry, not gas system, with the rifle length buffer tube, which adds a few inches on the back of your gun. I think it adds like 1.5 inches or something like that, which does add to the overall length. Now, even if I put your standard mil-spec buffer tube on here, it would still be longer than that 26 inches, so I can still run a vertical foregrip on it, so that's not really the issue. The reason that I'm running this rifle length buffer tube on here is to really help mitigate that recoil and recoil impulse, and as you'll see right here, this gun does recoil very, very smoothly when it's tuned properly. I have a very restrictive gas flow, and I have a very heavy buffer with a very powerful spring. Now, the one thing that I would like to change on here eventually is to change out the bolt, because the bolt is a chunk. It is very, very heavy, and so it's a lot of mass cycling back and forth. So reducing that would reduce some of the recoil, some of that impulse of that just slamming into the back of your gun, as well as having a little bit longer of a gas system. So there are two things that I could really change about it to smooth out the recoil. And actually, if I just switched out the barrel to a mid-length and shortened up this guy to a standard mil-spec or carbine with a very heavy buffer, I would probably end up with a very similar recoil impulse with what I have right now with a shorter overall package, which is what I want. So as it stands right now, the two biggest things that I would change about this setup is, number one, the optic setup that I have on here, namely just the red dot and the 3x magnifier. Not that they're bad, but they don't really belong on this specific setup. And I would like to change out the rear setup to something a little shorter, a little bit more compact, to make the overall package a little bit shorter, a little bit more portable, and, you know, easier to throw in the back of a car or a truck or something like that. And also a little bit more ergonomic, because as I said before, it is a much longer length of pull than I am generally used to. I like to have something that's really close and tight to my shoulder. Just for whatever reason, it's how I've shot a lot of my guns, and so it's what I'm used to. I don't know if that's the way you should be doing it, but it's what I like and what I'm used to. So as this guy is set up right now, it's a very, very fun gun just to take shooting at whatever sort of range that you're doing it at. It's very light recoiling for an AR-10 308. It is a little snappy still just because of that short gas system that you have on here, but overall I would say that it does have a very, very manageable recoil. And actually, even with all this crap on here, it's not all that heavy, sitting with an unloaded mag at about 8.5 pounds. And it's also not that heavy sitting in right now at about 8.5 pounds with an empty magazine in it. Most of that is due to the polymer lower receiver on here and the lower slash thinner profile barrel that it comes with. So if you are wanting to build a short-barreled AR-10 like this, I would say absolutely go for it. Just learn from some of my mistakes and make sure that you're building it for what you want to use it for. This guy here, as it stands, is very, very fun to shoot, even if it doesn't know what its purpose is in life right now, and it looks like it's been thrown together from a couple different builds, but it still is very, very fun to shoot, and it's still on its way to something else. So that's pretty much it for the video, guys. I hope you all enjoyed. There will be a full parts list of everything that I have on here down in the description down below, as well as links to support the channel if you feel inclined to do so. But that's just about everything for today. Thank you guys again so much for watching, and I will see you guys in the next one. Peace off. Oh, turn sideways again. Perfect.